Okay, so my name's Bradley Andersen. This is a talk about regular expressions. It says 101. I just had someone ask me a very complicated question. So it's really 101. It starts at the very beginning. So if you know, if you've used regular expressions before and you feel fairly confident, it's probably going to be very boring for you. So this is your chance to leave if you want. It starts out very, very 101, very simple. I start from the very beginning with literals. About halfway through, I start talking about how to look at it in a slightly different way, which I think is more intuitive. So maybe you'll find that more interesting. Okay, so I have a plan. I want to talk about what regular expressions are. I want to go into the 101 part, which is actually showing you some examples of regular expressions, how they work, and then I want to go into how they really work. And the point is, I think in real life, this is what happened with me, maybe it happens with other people, when you first are learning to parse things, or when you're looking for, when you want to use a regular expression, you find something that seems to meet what you're looking for, then you use it without really knowing what it's doing, and then later on you might get stuck because you've just been using things and you don't know what they're doing. So I'm hoping that maybe we can clear that up a little bit with this talk. And I'm not very good with PowerPoint. So this is, it's not a beautiful slideshow. So the plan is, like I just said, I want you to look at a regular expression, be able to think about what the regular expression is doing, rather than just try to use the thing without knowing what it's doing. I want to talk about what regular expressions are, what regular expressions are good for, what they're not good for. So regular expressions are like a language, right? In language, you have words and you have grammar. So a regular expression is like a sentence. It contains words, literals, like my name, Bradley. And it contains grammar, metacharacters, like the exclamation point, which properly goes after the word Bradley. We use regular expressions to describe patterns we want to find in some larger text. You might want to do something with the text that you find. You might want to know if the text matches only. You might want to know if the text doesn't match. So this is the 101 part. Basic string matching. So we have this fact that kelp is better than dancer. It's just a regular string with words in it. And I don't have a pointer. Is there a pointer? Or do I just do this? Oh, okay, got it. Okay, so you can see here that we have this string, kelp is better than dancer. We have this little thing, and we have these lines here. So these lines are called delimiters. That's the typical delimiter that you use for finding, for using a regular expression. This basically says, look in this string for this literal. Now, there's other ways to do this as well. Sometimes you're looking in a string, and the string has the delimiter in it already. So maybe your string has this character a lot in it. So then you can use a different delimiter, as long as you prefix it with the M. So you can use this M, and then you can use this, and it means exactly the same thing as this. So what else matches in there? Has everyone in here used regular expressions before, or can somebody tell me something else that might match in that string that we might be able to use? Will this match? Yep. That'll match because we're using, again, we've changed the delimiter this time to a brace, if I can get this thing, this time to a brace. And we've actually, if you look in here, it's looking for the literal character N followed by a space followed by a capital D. So right in here, it would seem to match. Now, what's this going to return if I just leave it like this and I'm looking for it? In Perl, it's going to return a true value. So usually we'll return 1 if we print this out. If I say, what's this printing out? Perl will say 1. Now, I can do other things, which I'll talk about later, like capture the match, and then I can name the match, and then I can do other things with the match after. But as it stands right now, if I run this, it's Perl's just going to tell me, one, I found it in there. And then there are meta characters. So within the context of a regular expression, you can have all these different characters. These are like the grammar that's added to the basic literals. This guy, these braces usually will mean we're looking for a certain number of matches. This brace will usually be for a character class. These parentheses are for capturing. This is for the start of a string, the end of a string. This matches anything usually except white space. And this guy's for alternation. We'll see all of these after. And these are some quantifiers. And this guy you can use to basically escape one of those meta characters in a regular expression. So here's an example of a character class. Character classes are nice. We can use them if we want to find a particular range of things. So this one, can anybody tell me what I'm looking for in this character class? Is this readable to everybody to begin with? Okay. What am I looking for with this? I'm looking for the word kelp, right? So I can have a small k with a big e, a large l with a small p. So this is one way to look for the word kelp using character classes. So this tells me I can pick either one of these with either one, followed by either one of these, followed by either one of these, followed by either one of these, and if any of those conditions match, then we get one. We get a true value. So what about this one? We've got a small k, a capital E, a small l, a capital P, and I've followed it by this little modifier I. So that's a nicer, a more compact way to write this. So we have kelp here, we have kelp here. These are both looking for the same thing. This is a little nicer because we don't care how the word kelp is written, we just care that the word kelp is in there somewhere. What's this gonna find? Can anybody tell me? Yeah. It will find either a B followed by an AT, or a C followed by an A followed by a T, or an R followed by an A followed by a T. And I'm going to be very, very pedantic about this, so I don't want to say that I'm looking for the word bat or the word cat or the word rat. If you want to really understand how regular expression engine works in Perl, you have to look at this as I want to find a B followed by an A, followed by a T in exactly that order. Or a C followed by an A, followed by a T in exactly that order. Or an R followed by an A, followed by a T. Because that's the way it's really looking at it. So meta characters that we talked about a minute ago, they're different within these character classes. So for example, this guy becomes a range operator within a character class, and we'll see that afterward. And this guy, this caret, which previously meant the start of a line, start of a string, this actually now negates the character class. And we'll see that in just a minute. So here's an example of the range operator. Do we know what this is looking for? This is looking for, I'm looking for an I followed by a T, followed by an E, followed by an M, followed by a 0, followed by a 1, or a 2, or. It's about the same as this. And I think I have a little example here. Let me try to find it if I can get it. Let's see. Oh. That doesn't seem to, this is what I want, right? Having trouble getting out of this slideshow. Oh, what's this? Well, I'm stuck. Hold on. Okay, what's this now? Bigger. Okay, so I think I have an example for this. Yeah, here's one example. Okay. So in this situation, we found the word bat. If you look at this thing, it said, the string is, I saw a bat in the house, and the regular expression is looking for either B-A-T or C-A-T or R-A-T. I was looking, here's the items one, this is what I was looking for. So in this case, I have this string, it says, we have many items, item 3 and item 5, any, you know, something I like. And the regular expression is the first one we saw already with the item and the character class 0 to 9 with the range operator in the middle. The range operator, by the way, if it's at the beginning or the end of the character class, it's just a regular dash because it wouldn't make any sense to have nothing in front of it and nothing behind it if it's a range. This example is just to show that those two regular expressions are the same. So, hold on. I didn't comment out everything. Okay. So you see it found item 3 because in the string it said, I have item 3, I have item 5, I have item, any item you like. It's a little bit clunkier than I thought it would be, so I may stop showing those examples. So have any of you used regular expressions before?
Yes.
Clearly you have, right? So how basic has this been so far? Very basic, right? So why are you here? What are you hoping to learn? Oh, you like the examples? Oh, okay. Yeah, I haven't seen, the reason that I'm trying to give this talk is because I've not seen too many regular expressions talks, and so I'm hoping that later on I can donate this talk and somebody else can fix it up and they can use it as a basis maybe for more advanced talks later. So that's why I'm attempting to give a talk. Ah, here we go. I don't know where that came from. Okay, so I said earlier, I mentioned that if you put the caret in the context of a regular expression at the beginning, it negates it. So what does this with the caret in the 0-9, 0 to 9 match? Yeah, not a number, right. And then here are some other special characters that you can use, like character classes. The first one, this matches digits, so it matches this kind of thing here. This matches any this matches white space. This matches a word, and if you have a capitalized version, it matches the opposite. So this matches not a number. This matches not a white space, and this matches not a word. So can anybody tell me what this kind of thing will match here? We've got, it's looking for a digit, and then another digit, and then a colon, followed by another digit, followed by another digit, followed by a colon, followed by a digit, followed by another digit. I think later on we'll see an example of that at work. Oh, that came in the wrong place. So matching across multiple lines is often a problem. You have a regular expression like this, the word regular, it's just any regular expression. In this context, the match anything character will match any character except a new line. It won't match at the front or the end of the string. If you put this little S modifier on it, it treats the string like one line. So now the match anything character matches also the new line. If you put this guy, the M, instead, and now it treats it like multiple lines, and these special characters match at the beginning of or end of any line. And if you put the S and the M together, it says the string is one long line, but it knows about individual lines. So here's an example. Again, the fact that kelp is better than dancer. You can see we have embedded new lines in here. So this is really kelp is better than new line dancer. And that's in the variable X. So now we're looking to see if dancer matches at the start of the string, because we've got that caret, right? So in this case, it doesn't match because dancer is not at the start of the not at the start of the string. Kelp is. In this case, again, even with the S modifier, it doesn't match because dancer is not at the start of the string. Now in this case, because we're treating it with the M modifier, dancer is at the start of the second line, so now this matches. You see how it changes the way the meta characters operate. I have more examples like this, but we kind of lost a little time, so I'm going to skip those. So at this point, we'll go into some alternation and grouping. We've got this string kelp and dancer. And we're looking in the string kelp and dancer for either K followed by E followed by L followed by P, or D followed by A followed by N followed by C followed by E followed by R, or B followed by R, I followed by R followed by D. So I'm not thinking, does it have kelp or dancer or bird? I'm thinking of the individual characters. I think that's a good way to think about it. So in this case, it matches the word kelp. We'll find out later why it matches the word kelp. But basically, one of the rules is it tries to find the earliest possible match. And unless we modify it, it tries to find the biggest one that still matches. So in this case, we've changed it to either dancer or kelp or bird. Again, it finds kelp. And I know I just read those like that, but again it finds kelp because kelp matches earliest in the string. You can find more things like this if you put this into an array, and we'll do something like that after. In this case, we're looking, the string is Stefan likes kelp, and we want to match either a K or a K followed by an E, or a K followed by an E followed by an L, or a K followed by an E followed by an L followed by a P. In this case, it matches the K because that's the first thing it finds. It's the earliest match there. This is the same thing. I just changed it. So we're gonna pick on Jeff Avery a little bit. Since we already picked on Stefan, we're gonna look at some alternations. So do we want to find the name Jeff, or do we want to find the name Jeff? So the British Jeff or the American Jeff? So we can look like this. Jeffrey can be spelled J followed by E F F R E Y or J E F F E R Y, which can be changed, right? Because J E F F is in both of them, so why not reuse it? So then we put this group here, this parentheses, which and the alternating, the or, so now we can say if we have a J followed by an E followed by an F followed by an F followed by either an R and an E and then a Y, or an E or an R or a Y. So this is the same as this. This is another one that's the same because again the Y is reused in both of those, so we can make it like the J E F F or R E or E R and then Y. And if we want to add the Jeff part in there, the British version or the guy in the back, you can put the G-E-O-F-F because the rest of those pieces match already. And then we add this back in, so because they both have an F in it, so we can look for a G followed by an E followed by an O or a J followed by an E, and then two Fs followed by either an R, then an E, then a Y, or an E, then an R, then a Y. And then we can switch this like we did up here, so it's even more complicated. And we can even use the counting that to specify the number of matches we want. So this says find an F, find two Fs in a row. So now we've got a G, an E, an O, or a J, an E, followed by two Fs, followed by either R, E, or E, R, followed by Y. So this should find every variation of the name Jeffrey. And again, it still won't because we're not paying attention to case here. So we could add the little I modifier at the end and find it in any case. I'm going to talk about in a little bit why this is not something you should do. But I'm just showing, I'm making a point. So there are some other special characters when you, if you want to find, you know, if we're doing one of these matches and we want to find what was matched, this character holds what is matched. It's a dollar sign followed by ampersand symbol. This captures what was right before the match. So the whole string up until the match, and the part after the match. You can also use these characters, dollar sign one, dollar sign two, all the way up to, I don't know, I think it's 99. You can hold the first match, the second match. Anything that you've put parentheses around counts as, goes into one of these registers here. And it goes from left to right. So sometimes it can be difficult to count those. And there's a better way to count those that I'm not going to get into because it's very complicated. You use these kind of things outside of a regular expression. And I pronounce this word regex, not regex, because it's not a regular expression. It's a regular expression. But it's harder to say, so most people just say regex. So you use these outside of a regular expression. You basically, if you want to do something with the thing that you matched, you use these. These are back references. We'll talk about that in a minute. Basically, you use those inside of a regular expression if you want to match something that you already matched and possibly do something with it. So here's an example for the back reference. I've got a string which really reads, this is some text, but you know by now it's really a T followed by an H followed by a little bit to a T. And I want to search that string for the word for this series of letters, an S followed by an O followed by an M followed by an E. That's in there, right? We find that in here. And so I'm doing a search here, and then I'm replacing it. I've added an extra delimiter there. I'm replacing it. I'm basically putting a bold tag around the word sum. So what it's doing here is it's looking for the word sum. If it finds it, it puts it in this guy, and then it changes this guy to have these around it. And you can use the dollar sign here as well. So in this case, this text would become, this is B tag sum and B tag text. I don't think I put that on there, but. So something about back references. I have a regular expression. What is this regular expression looking for? Can anybody tell me?
This number followed by the same number followed by any other number.
Right. So it's looking for a number and then a space. You can make the space more apparent, but if you put just blank space in there, it works. Followed by the same number, right, because it's captured into the one register, followed by a space, followed by some other number. And you notice that we put these parentheses around it so that we've got it captured. So what's it going to find in here? Let's see what it finds. Oh, there's another thing there. So I want to find all of the matches, so I put it into an array. This is a compact way of writing it. I wouldn't suggest this. I would always opt for simplicity. But in this case, I've got basically check the string, this guy, for that regular expression, this guy, and put any matches. This will save all of the matches. And the same thing with this. So basically, you're right. What this will find here is a 1 and then a 3. The first match will be a 1. The second match will be a 3 because it finds the 1 here, and then it finds the repeated 1. And then after that, it finds, the next thing it finds is the 3. You can name back references. This is sort of like that example I showed you earlier with the digit, digit, colon, digit, digit, colon, digit, digit. So that could be used to find a time, date time there. And it, so there's another way you could write this, right? You could make this more compact. You could do slash digit curly brace 2, right? And then you'll find 2 digits followed by a colon, followed by 2 digits followed by a colon. You could make that even more terse, but it's really hard to read. And so
it's anyway hard to read. Which year is
19
months?
Okay, yeah. It's hard to read in any case, but you can make it more difficult to read. In this case, so this is a named back reference. You can, if you put this little question mark and you give it the name that you want to give it in front of what you're looking for. So I'm going to name the first thing I find a month, the second thing a day, the third thing a year. That's awfully Americanized, I know. So there are other ways to write this, but I'm just trying to make the point. You can pretend this is a D and this is an M if you want. And so then later on, the matches go to this particular hash. So I can say here that I matched this day and this month and this year with this peculiar syntax. Numbers of repetitions. Okay, so if you put a question mark after what you're looking for, it'll match it 1 or 0 times. It'll match it as many times as it can find it. The asterisk means match it 0 more times, which means it'll match all the time because it can match 0 times. The plus means match it 1 or more times, at least once. NM, so we put the 2 in there earlier, that means find it at least this many times, but no more than that many times. Match at least this many times, so we could put 5 in there, and if there's 8 of them, it'll match. This means match exactly N times, like the F earlier where we did the F and then the 2. These are greedy modifiers. If you put another question mark at the end of any of these, it makes it non-greedy, which means it'll match the fewest number of times. So here's a big example. Okay. So we want to look in the string kelp is better than dancer for this regular expression. So we've got at the beginning of the string, we've got anything 1 or more times, then an E or an R, then anything, right, at the end of the string. So the first match is kelp is better than dance. So why did it match that? Well, it can match any number of any character up until an E or an R. And so it sees this, and then it stops. And the next match is the R. That's the second thing that it found. And in this case, we can look at the same string again, but I'm looking at a different regular expression. I'm looking at the letter T 1 or 2 times, followed by anything. So the first match is TT here, because that's the first time it finds 1 or more T's. And then the rest of it is what matches after. In this case, it's looking for anything before the T 1 or 2 times, and then anything. And it finds the T 1 time, and then it finds the rest of it after that last T. I'm low on time. I didn't think I would be, so. This is one thing that's very important. This is the earlier example, and I've even added something to it at the end. I added all these different things, different casing, and the F, and then I added the I at the end. Which one of these is the best way to do it? At some point when you write your code, somebody else is going to have to read it and modify it, and it's really nice of you if you make it so it's easy for them to read it and modify it. So I wouldn't go with any of these. I would go with this. Because it's very clear what I'm looking for here. This is none of these, in my opinion. I mean, this is really unclear. You can understand what this means, but I think this is a lot nicer. This will not match as many things because it won't match the, but. So this is just something about readability. I took this example online. This is presumably to find a floating point number. Good luck. So this is supposed to find numbers. So here's a better way that I also took. This is from a regular expressions tutorial. This is exactly the same thing, but if you put this X modifier at the end, you can put in pretty much arbitrary white space and comments. So if you're going to put this in your code, you'll look like a, you know, some kind of badass, and it might be nice for a little while. But if you put this in there, I think the people you work with will thank you. I mean, it's exactly the same thing. And it's got comments. This is what I'm trying to do. You shouldn't use a regular expression if you are trying to parse HTML or XML. I've got a link up there, which I'll put up later, that shows that basically explains why not. If you're trying to validate an email address, good luck. You can end up with thousands of characters of regular expression, and it won't work for them all. He's got an example on this page where at 6,000, you know, it's supposed to do everything, but it still treats this as a regular, as a valid email address. So that's something you can look at in a little bit. If you're writing an obscenity filter, no. It's basically knowing what you're trying to do. If you need to do something one-off and it's, you know, it's easy, do it. But if you're going to try to do something that's really complicated like this, weigh the benefits first before you do it. It's very easy to break something like that. What's happening now? Go. Oh, here we go. Okay, so how regular expressions really work. A regular expression, basically what happens is the Perl compiles the regular expression into a compact series of opcodes that can fit inside the processor cache. When the code's executed, the opcodes can run, blah, blah. So basically what happens is a regular expression is a simple machine. It gives you a yes or a no answer. And it checks one character at a time. So this is a neat way that I like to think about it. It's called, I found this in an old Perl article called Penny Machines. So we have this string A followed by B followed by A followed by A, and we have this regular expression, which is the caret with this capturing group A or B, and then anything, and then A. So does this match? Will we find, what will we find here if we put, will this return one? I won't go over this. You can read this after because we're almost out of time. But so here's a machine for that regular expression. Basically, you have these different states. This is a start state, this M. This is an end state. And if I were good at PowerPoint, this would be animated. But as it is, it's terrible. So basically, you start here and you move along. And if you're at the end of the regular expression and you're here, then it matches. And this is basically how Perl looks at it. So in this case, we're looking at the start of the string for an A or a B. Well, we can follow A to here, which is this. I tried to do it with the red. And now we're here. Now at this point, we are looking for, we can look for a B, or we can look for anything, and then another A. So we can follow this line back to here, the B line, and we're back here again. And now if we had another B, we could just keep looping here, B, 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 B. But instead, we found another A up here. And so we move here, and that's the end of the regular expression. We could just keep going A, A, A. But now, since we ended up here, Perl's going to tell us that there's a match because we ended on the end state. This is I'll put this up on the web, but this is a discussion basically to show you how you can take any arbitrarily complex regular expression, break it down into little parts like this, and draw one of these so that you can go over it and try to understand what it's really doing. And then there's another example. Okay, so I guess this will be the last example. So again, with the kelp and the Stefan, we've got this text, which reads, and then kelp said Stefan is better than Dancer, and he was gone. So what's that going to match? Is that going to match kelp? Is it going to match said Stefan? Is it going to match is better than Dancer? So the point here is we've got this regular expression, which is looking to match quote, and then anything, any number of times, and then quote. And you can actually build one of those machines. I've got a very beautiful picture of it next for this. But basically, we can get rid of these green ones right away. Why? It's not going to match these green ones because it starts to match at the earliest point in the text. So said Stefan is already beyond this, so it's not going to match. Is better than Dancer, it's already beyond the first one, it's not going to match. in the end, it's going to match that. Kelp said Stefan is better than Dancer. So it's going to match this whole thing here. Because again, we didn't modify it at all. It's looking for the leftmost, and it's looking for the most. And here's actually, this is a a state machine for that regular expression. So it's looking for a quote character, and then it's looking for anything, any number of times, and then another quote character. And since this can any number of times can match zero times, once you get here with the quote character, you can actually just bypass this whole thing, and it will match if there's nothing there. So it'll match an empty quote right there. This is the treat of the conference, this picture. So basically, here's the rules. The leftmost match, the earliest possible wins. It starts reading it this way to this way. So that's why we can cancel the green ones right away. The second rule is that optional matches always match, so a regular expression that requires no matches will match. And when the engine has more than one path to choose from, it chooses one path and then caches the other and backtracks if it doesn't match. So think about being in the woods. Okay. Think about being in the woods and you're at a path. You have two different paths to take. You take this path. If you don't find what you want, you remember the path that you started at, that you were at the last. You go back to that path and try a different path. That's the way Perl's doing it. Basically, if it's a greedy modifier, Perl's always going to try the optional path first. Otherwise, it's going to skip the optional path first. And here's another example, but I have no time. So basically, here's a nice thing to try to explain regular expressions if you need help with it. You can get this Yape Regex explain and put it in like this, and it will give you an output like this, which tells you, here's what I'm going to put into one, here's what I'm going to put into two, here's what I'm trying to match. It explains to you what you're trying to match. There are other tools that do this, but this works nicely. Here's a summary. It just tells you we went over literals, meta characters, efficiency, readability. And here's some good references. This guy here I like a lot. You can type a regular expression in. It'll show you in the text you've got there what you're matching as you type it. This is the Regular Expressions book by Jeffrey Friedel. This is the Perl Online documentation, and this is for Kelp if you want to get something, a nice micro web framework that was written by a guy from Sofia. That's it. Thank you for being patient.